Coco, how you doing? On your bones.
All right. I worked through my, although this felt like a long week, it was a short week. Through my studies, went live.
Oh, good.
And yeah, I was happy about that. And I was also happy that a problem study was pulled and they're going to go elsewhere. We can't consult to do things that are unethical as proposed by the FDA, and that's what they're asking us to do. So it was best that we end our relationship with that pharmaceutical company, and that's what we did. But other than that, yeah, this has been okay. Like, this weekend has really been good and relaxing.
I'm trying to get out and go a couple places. Y'all heard my little thing with that damn Buffalo Wild Wings shit.
Girl, I think that it depends, because I don't know if you remember, but I had told you I didn't used to like them. What happened was, I went to a Buffalo Wild Wings in D.C., and it was horrid. And I had told my brother, he was like, no. He was like, it's one around me, and it's really good. And I was like, no, them wings are still clucking, man. So I went to the one around him, and I was like, okay, this tastes like a completely different place. And then I went to the one around me. So although it's a chain and some of them are really good, and you know how they say, well, we all got the same recipe, so it should taste the same, but the same recipe interpreted different ways will taste different. And you need to come on down to Morristown, girl. I'll even join you, and we can go.
If you gonna call yourself Buffalo Wild Wings, I would expect that your wings would be good, because that's been the name of your restaurant. When I tell you them that's wings, on a scale of 1 to 10, them wings was like a -4. That's like, they was like, it's like, this is it. And then the funny part, we just had regular ones. We had like the mayo, we had I ordered some orange, like, they were called like,
habanero, the mango orange.
No, they was like, oriental orange or something like that. They was like the pit. That, I'm glad we ordered other stuff other than wings, because the wings, now the regular food was fine, but the wings that we ordered, they was horrible.
And you know something, it looked like yours was kind of still clucking.
No, they was well done.
Oh, was they?
They was done, they just didn't eat.
Okay, I gotta mention something, because I wasn't gonna mention this, but I have to mention it since we're on the thing of food. So yesterday, after I dropped my daughter off, I wanted to go and get me a drink, because they had half-price martinis at the Houlihan's. Okay? I've been to Houlihan's a lot of times, but now you can sit in at the bar. So I said, okay. I called before I went, and I said, do you have room at the bar? So then the hostess said, well, I was on the phone with her. She said, I'm the hostess. There's nobody in here right now. But yeah, you can come in and sit at the bar, but you just have to do six seats away from each other. I said, okay. So she's like, but I can't guarantee you a seat if you... I was like, well, I'm right outside, so don't worry. I had already came, but I just wanted to know. I don't want to sit outside and drink. And I'm by myself. So I went into the bar. I saw her. I see a young one who called. She's like, yeah, just make sure it's six seats away. So I went in and I sat down at the bar. I wasn't even going to mention this. Like I said, I didn't even tell my family. So I went in and I sat down. But I did post and blast them on Facebook. Y'all know how I do. I sat at the bar. So then this other hostess comes over. So I heard her talking about some miss. But I kept on looking at the menu, because I'm saying to myself, she ain't talking to me. So she comes over and was like, you can't just walk in here and sit down. You have to wait to be seated, even at the bar. So I said, first of all, who are you talking to? I said, I'm a grown woman. I said, you don't come over here and approach me like that. I said, not to mention, I didn't just come in here and walk in here and sit down. There was another hostess there, and she told me to come in here and sit down. So then she said, well, that's not what you're supposed to do. I said, yeah, but as soon as I just now told you that the hostess told me to come in here and sit down, you shouldn't be saying nothing else out your mouth. So then we just had an odd moment of silence for a while. She looked at me. I looked at her all half crazy. So then I really, really wanted this Bahama Mama, because the Bahama Mamas, they're good. They're like real big. You only need one. And I mean, that's all I really wanted. I had a hard week. I just wanted a drink. I was going to treat myself. okay, so then I start thinking. I said, you're the fool. If you're going to sit here and you are going to give this place your money, I don't care how many times you've been here, and let these people just be disrespectful. So I got up and I left, and she was at the door, the rude one. So I said, you know something, like you told me, you know, you said that you needed to keep a count. I'm letting you know my seat is now free. So I walked on out the door. So when I got home, I didn't even call. I just did my whole Facebook thing, detailing everything that happened. So the manager did try and contact me this morning. I told him that he asked me for my number and for my email address. And I told him, I gave my number and my email address. And I told him, don't, because he contacted me through Facebook. I said, you don't even have to contact me today, because I got my show today and I want to remain in a positive place. And at the end of the day, it was just, it's really no call for what happened, especially not since not only have I been a good customer, but I'm also a good tipper. All you gotta do is give me good service. And I know it says a certain amount of percent, but no, I'll have a $20 bill and still give you like $10 to $12. But I don't do it for service that's not good or just being disrespectful and rude, because that could have went a thousand of a different ways. But I'm a lot older and I'm a lot wiser now, so I just took my money elsewhere. To the
store. I want to know how come one hostess had a totally different mind frame than it was a hostess. Like, if you guys are both doing the same job, why are you saying one thing and she's saying another?
Yeah, that was the same thing that my daughter said.
Because it's like, you told me to come in here, you told me that I can't. So I'm going to sit right here till y'all figure out what I'm supposed to do. You talk to her and she can talk to you. Like, I didn't understand, like, why is it she had a totally different mindset than the other hosts? Like,
I don't know. What was up with that? And I feel bad because, like, I mean, I used to go there a lot, and I never seen her there before. I don't want to just stop going because of that, but then, I don't know. I'll see what the manager has to say, but I really have to, I don't know. I have to think about whether or not I'll ever go back in the future. But you're right. Why are they being told two different things? And why is it that, is that really what happens? Because what she told me on the phone and when I came in was the same story. So did this new hostess come in and change it around? Like, it seemed like the other one was getting off. So, I don't know.
It sounded like to me there was like a lack of communication between the staff. So my thing is, if they were offering me something I really, really wanted, I might have stayed to get what it was that I wanted, but I would have let her talk to the other hostess. Y'all figure out what it is y'all want me to do. I'm going to let y'all argue it out, because I ain't going to say, like, you did the right thing by not arguing with her, because I wouldn't argue with her either. But, like, I don't understand how, like, 2 seconds ago, I was told to come in and sit down, and now you're telling me that I can't, that I have to wait until you tell me to come in. Like,
I didn't argue, but I wasn't nice either. Like, I told her off, I just didn't raise my voice. But the other hostess had already gotten off, because I was sitting there for a while, because I was really, they have a lot of drinks and martinis, and I was all like, okay, should I get a chocolate martini? Should I get the Bahama Mama? Should I get a blue Hawaiian? Like, I had a lot of choices there. It's been a while since I had, like, a real good drink.
But this is the funny part, though. What I don't understand about people in the hospitality realm is that we all know that these businesses haven't been making money and they've been shut down, they've been closed. Now that you guys are open, I would like to think that you would be doing everything in your power to accommodate whoever want to come into your establishment and spend money. You know what I mean? I don't care if I did sit down, I was supposed to sit down. I would like to think that you would go, you know what, bitch? You came in here before I told you, but that's how you're going down, because so much. That's what I don't understand. Like, I don't understand how you could tell me I have to wait and I can't do this and I can't do that, where I'm here to spend my money.
But the other part is, there are some people in the hospitality industry that are getting laid off due to the lack of business, like in the hotels and things like that. And what killed me is when you go to, like, even like a Chipotle or Panda Express, it's like, oh, you have to call your order in. It's like, it's nobody in there. Why do I have to call my order?
I don't understand that either. And I know what you're talking about. It's like some of them don't want you to come in. Did you call it in? Can I just cut me an order?
When he did the other day, we were somewhere, they told him he had to call his order in. He stood at the front. He said, "Oh, I gotta call my order in." The lady's like, "Yes." This is what he said. "I would like a cheesesteak with large fries," and that's what he did. So he did call it in. He just stood in front of the fucking thing. That's what he did. He got his stuff. But the whole point is, like, I understand that there are certain protocols and things like that. But if I'm here and I'm spending my money in your establishment, you should accommodate me. You should be bending over backwards to accommodate me.
That's what I thought too.
Yeah. I would like to think that's you.
Dave and Buster's, we was in there, and we bowled for 2 hours, and then the boys was running around playing the game. So we wanted to go sit and get some more wings and another beverage, and they told us, "You have to wait 35 minutes. There's a waiting list." There was only 2 people in the waiting area. And I'm like, "We gotta wait 35 minutes when we've been in here for 4 hours? Like, I don't understand."
What was you waiting 35 minutes for?
To be able to sit down. And you can only get a beverage if you order the entree.
I mean, I understand the whole, you can only get a beverage if you order an entree because they're trying to get the best bang for their buck.
I don't understand that either.
If I've already been here for 4 hours, I shouldn't have to go nowhere and wait an additional 35 minutes to be seated. If y'all already fed me, if I already wing and I want some more, why 35 minutes?
Oh, no, we had a doggy bag. So you already know we ate there. So now you're telling me we gotta order another entree, which was fine because we were going to get wings again. So then we go into the gaming area, right? You're in the gaming area. There's no chairs, no seats, nothing. So we stand up at this, like, island. And so he started eating the wings that he already had. They come over and say, "You can't eat that in here." But we brought them. I was like, "See, this is what happens. Just like you said."
I just refuse to, and y'all know that I even stopped going, I'm not even going to mention it on here, I've stopped going to my favorite place because the quality has went down so much. And if I order a takeout meal from you, and I'm sitting down and I'm waiting for it, I shouldn't be charged gratuity. Huh?
No, I'm talking to Angel. She's on the table.
I was charged gratuity, and then they even tried to overcharge me on my card and put in an order 2 times, and my bank had to pull it back. My bank was the one who alerted me. Like, "We suspect fraud on your card." I'm like, "Wait, what? No, I did go there." She's like, "You didn't go there 2 times in a row. These charges came through at the same time." And I'm like, "Ugh, I don't know what's going on with them." And y'all know that was like one of my favorite places. I have to fall back. So I really don't know what's going on.
I think so many changes with staffing and how they do things that I understand, but I think what's happening is they have so many different rules. A lot of rules are convoluted. They don't make any sense. And what's happening with me, like I told y'all, y'all was laughing when I said it, I'm gonna stay my black ass home, because a lot of stuff that I see going on in restaurants and stuff like that, it's not pleasing to me. And I'll be damned if I'm be spending my money in your establishment and you gonna treat me crazy, or you gonna have me follow all these dumbass rules. And then like I said, when I eat the food ain't even that good. So I might as well just stay home. I'm good on it. Because guess what? Them damn wings I had the other day, my dog could have made better wings than that. Like, it was like, I don't even know what did we spend this money on? Like, it didn't make any sense to me. But it's like, okay, cool. I'm just starting to appreciate my food for
it. Yeah, I ordered from Chipotle. I got the delivery. Not that a burrito bowl came to $26, okay? And granted, it was, you know how much stuff they put on there. I tell you, it was ice cold to the point where the cheese didn't even melt. Now, sometimes when you go there and get it and you get the cheese on it, by the time you open it up, the heat from the other, like the rice and the chicken, would have had the cheese ice cold. I was like, spent $26 for a readable.
I think it's crazy how, like, a lot of these services now that get you food from wherever you want, the markup on the food that you're buying is insane. Like, it don't even make no sense, because I know one time we ordered from Moonlight. I think we ordered through Grubhub. We got, like, some shrimp and, like, another thing. It came to, like, $60. I was like, this is crazy. Like, the markup on the food that you're ordering is insane. It's like, I know we're paying, like, a computer. I get, but damn.
I saw it on the news. It's like a 15% markup.
Mm-hmm. It's crazy. I was like, hell, I could have gotten the car and drove up there for this. Like, the food that I ordered literally probably should have came to about maybe like $27,
$28.
Or maybe I'll get a 30. I'll get a 30 for $35 at the moment. Why did I wind up paying like $60? Like, it didn't make any sense. It's like, why did I pay $60 for three things? Like, it just didn't make any sense. But you know what? I guess.
It's all kind of handling and shipping and service charges.
It's crazy. I guess this is the price that you pay for convenience, but like I said, I don't get my own food better anyway. I ain't gonna keep ordering from these places and then the food ain't half right and I got to pay a 15-20% markup on the food. Like, it just doesn't make any sense to me. It's crazy. So, I'm gonna chill with this stuff. Like, I can't do it. I let them order a lot of times. I'm not happy with the stuff I've been getting.
I went to Relish and got some turkey wings. Now, Relish menu now is a predetermined menu. So, everything, like if you get your Southern fried chicken or something like that, it comes with mashed potatoes and greens.
You can't choose your sides like before?
Huh?
You can't choose your sides?
No. And I wanted stuffing. That's really why I wanted the turkey wings for the stuffing. But they don't have stuffing, right? So I was like, fine, I'll get us some platters. So go and get the platters. And I see they had outdoor seating. So we were like, oh, can we, you know, sit out here and eat? Oh, you got to make reservations.
Yeah, but I haven't spent about $50, $60, $70 a month. It just don't make sense.
Me
it's
either.
Crazy. They don't even let you book them. You got to go to the window and tell them your name, and then they have it all bagged up and handed to you out the window.
I think I'm going to start falling back, too. Because I can make food good, so I don't, and I don't mind paying money for food, but I'm not paying for no crappy service. And then after it's crappy, guess what? I don't want you to call me to talk about it just because I put it out there. I'm putting it out there so other people know. But I don't want you to call and let's make a deal and can I take it down? No. This was how you were in the raw, and people should know.
Yeah. They should.
Your Facebook proof. Did you tag Blue Hands or something? How did they even know that you had a complaint?
I put it on their page.
Oh, you put it on their page.
Mm-hmm. Right on their page. Hula Hands Cheerio. Because there was just no reason for that. But with the quality of the food, and I'm not even putting them out there, y'all know that I love that place and how much I went there. The other place that I will not name. But it just went all downhill. Like, it was one time that we got wings and we threw them out. They tasted horrible. And I had just brought them home. Like, I can't do it. I know that those are not the regular cooks that's back there. I could taste the difference.
Well, I'll tell you the fucking part. Let this be a lesson for all of us. Because you know what it's forcing people to do? It's forcing people to cook. It's forcing people to cook and just cook at home. Like, cook your own food. Because, yes, it probably be better than 9 times out of 10 anyway. Because, it ain't known. So, like,
you're right.
A bit more effort into it, but you might have to just start cooking your own stuff.
Wait a second, I don't know how to make no Bahama Mama.
you can Google it.
Look it up. You can find out how to make a Bahama. You got a blender. You do.
Okay.
You don't need a blender. Get a shaker.
Blender, shaker, whatever. Just get what it is you need. Your own damn drink. You'll be alright. Ryan's spirits is open. You can go get whatever you need. well, your liquor store. Go to the Roger Wilco or wherever the hell you go.
Roger Wilco.
Go get your liquor. You be alright.
It's cheaper anyway. That's what I see.
To make your own, yeah.
So
lesson learned for all of us.
Oh, 17-17.
All right, so, and just so y'all know now, the game is tied with the Washington and Eagles, 17-17.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Oh, my address, we need to play that number.
Yeah. All right, so, let's get into some of our stories, because, I mean, watching some of this week was comical. So, you know, Trump said that, you know, this whole coronavirus thing is coming, making a final turn, making a final run. And Fauci disagrees and said, absolutely not.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we know that.
Well, I think this was the point. President Trump gave an interview. He did a series of interviews with this guy, Bob Woodward, from the Washington Post. And what he did was, he admitted that he downplayed the virus.
Yep.
He said he knew, yeah, he knew it was deadly. He knew it was going to kill a lot of people. He knew it was coming. And instead of him saying that on TV, he got on TV and said, oh, it's going to go away like the flu. It's not going to be around that long. I don't know if y'all remember his first interview.
I do. And he said the mask really didn't matter.
It's going to go away. I don't want anybody to panic. I'm going to... So, basically, he admitted that he lied to the American people, is what he did.
Yeah.
Because, why would you want to call it? But he admitted it on a text. He was like, I downplayed it a lot because I didn't want people to panic. I mean, I can understand him not wanting people to fall into a panic, but it's one thing to say something and it not be true. If you're saying it to millions and millions and millions of people, like, you're telling people that it's going to go away. A lot of these dumbass people really listen
they
to the
believe
president.
It.
They really listen to the people what he say.
Well, just so everybody does know, Fauci did say that really, before this goes away, we'll be well into 2021 and probably really towards the end of 2021 before we really do get back some type of normalcy from COVID.
But this is the point.
Bolton thing, like those plexi shields and all of that up. You knew it wasn't going anywhere. Yeah. It wasn't temporary.
Because they was making permanent like fixtures to me by putting all those things up.
And the same thing
I don't know if those permanent fixtures, because all it is the piece of plexi glass and some nails, but
when you're nailing something in, this is not going away in a few months.
No.
I don't know, but I'm just thinking. I just think that if he had more knowledge of what this was and how it was coming, why weren't we more prepared? Why didn't he prepare the American people? Why didn't we have the PPE that we needed? Or he could have gave everybody a heads up and say, listen, we need to start preparing because this is coming.
Some people took it lightly, and we had a lot of deaths over this. Like, this ain't serious.
They're still taking it lightly.
Well, some people take it lightly, not everybody.
The funny part is, you think we could have prevented a lot of the deaths that happened? I think people were just going to catch it and die anyway. I don't really think him not saying what it was made people die for. I just think people were going to die, period. That's my opinion. I just think people were going to die from it.
I do, too, but if he would have mentioned it, I think that people would have been more precautious if they really knew the details of it.
You know what the funny part is that I'm noticing... I don't care how precautious you are. If you're going to catch it, you're going to catch it. And depending on your body, you might die. You know what I'm saying? Because I just think with anything, it's like something, the natural progression of life. Just like in the wild. You know how people say that a certain percentage of them die and a certain percentage of them live? I think that's how it is when it comes to pandemics and stuff like this. Because we had like smallpox. Certain amount of people died, certain amount of people lived.
Well,
we had the rubella, you know, a lot of people lived and a certain amount of people died. I don't think that he could have done anything to maybe stop how many people have gotten sick. But the funny part was, my biggest issue with him is, why lie about it? If you know what's coming and they told you how serious it was, why would you convey to the American public? That's my problem with it. Because there was going to be a certain amount of people that died. But you didn't have to lie about it. You didn't have to lie about it. And believe it or not, I think that is going to be one of the big sticking points in this election. Because I don't think people are going to forget that. I don't think people are going to allow you to sit up there and tell lie after lie after lie. It's one thing to lie about certain things, but it's another thing to lie about something that could possibly kill a lot of people. And you blatantly lied about it. You just said it was gonna go away. You said, we're gonna look up and it's gonna be gone. Like, it just don't make sense.
I think some people are so wrapped up into him that it doesn't matter what he says. It's like, you know, it's a way they go with wherever he goes. They say, oh, he said it's going to be over soon. Well, he didn't want to scare people. That's why he didn't say anything.
And I heard him saying that too. You're right. He didn't want people to break out in a panic.
Don't keep us from panicking. And he was just trying to, that's all they wanted to say.
What I don't understand, I've never understand people who follow other people blindly. And when I say blindly, I'm not just talking about politics. You ever see people who like go to church and stuff like that and they follow their pastor no matter what their pastor say? Or you ever see people at work? You might be looking at a manager and you know damn well the manager ain't shit. They don't know what they talking about. Somebody will follow him just period. Oh, because he's the manager. I don't understand people who think like that. There are a lot of people who think like, I'll follow somebody blindly. Just because somebody say it, they just hop on for it and they'll follow. And the funny part is, my personality is the opposite. You gotta show them proof. You can tell me anything. That don't mean I'm gonna believe your ass. I just don't.
Not to mention, just because you're the manager or the whatever, when you say something, I mean, my brain reacts normal. If I don't agree with it, in my head, I'll be saying, oh, that's some bullshit. I mean, but it's just normal thinking. I'm not going to agree with everything that you say just because you are the manager.
Well, the funny part is, I think that's the biggest problem with me and my mother, because my mother is the kind of person, when she says something, she thinks because she's the mother, you're supposed to agree. And guess what? 9 times out of 10, I got a question about it. I ain't saying I don't agree, but I'm going to ask you some questions about it. That's her problem with me. And she was saying, you always got to be the one to ask you, damn. I question everything, because guess what? My father was that way. He said, no, you always question everything. He said, if something ain't sitting right in your spirit, go ahead and question it. And guess what? I'm sorry, that's just me. That's me. And that's with anything or anybody.
And even when I'm going through a regulatory, and if they try to point out a deficiency, I'll be like, wait a minute. I'll be like, can you tell me what tag number that is and what reg you're referencing? Because you're not going to accept me that we have deficiency in something that I know is not a deficiency.
So where did that come from?
To prove. And I'll be like, and sometimes I have to watch how I work for it, because they always think like I'm being defensive or something. But I'll just be like, well, for my knowledge.
That's a good one.
In my mind, I'm saying, but I'd be like, for my knowledge, can you tell me what tag number that is and what regulation you're referencing? Just so I can look it up so we can be better prepared next time.
I hate this. When I go into meetings, especially when I go into like my appraisals and stuff like that, when I go into my yearly appraisal meeting, I hate to say this, I feel like I've been preparing for you. My appraisal might be great, and it might not be any problems, but I go prepared. I read up on everything. I know who you're going to say to me. I done figured it out. I done read it 4 times. Like, I prepare. I probably over-prepare for everything, because I'm the kind of person, I don't like to sit in a meeting and somebody mentions something. I go, okay, well, I have to get back with you on that. No, I want to talk about it right now, right here. Let's discuss it right now. I got to talk about it now. I can't wait. So I over-prepare for me. I over-prepare all the time. And I be saying, damn, I didn't even get a chance to bring that up. Because, I read so much stuff about stuff. I do that all the time. I didn't even have a chance to say that. I was waiting to say this. And the funny part, one of my colleagues told me that wasn't a good way to be. And I understood what he was thinking, how don't prepare for the worst. He said, because if you go in with the attitude that you're preparing for the worst, then you're more pissy, you're more, you know, you're more agitated, whatever. I said, no, it's not that I'm preparing for the worst. I'm just, I need to prepare myself for whatever they can say to me. I need to have a comeback, a retort. I got to be able to understand what you're saying to me. I got to have some kind of ammunition in my pocket so I can come back at you. And when I say come back at you, I don't mean necessarily negatively come back at you. If you bring something up, I have to be prepared to discuss it. Like, I don't want to say, can we talk about it later? No, I want to talk about it right now.
No, I have meat to present, like quality data, and I'm presenting the quality data. And then you always have that one in the audience that want to be like, well, wait a minute, what's your threshold? And then I'll be like, oh, our threshold is this amount. Well, then, what do you do? So it's like, okay. I was like, all right, this happened early on in my career. So now I come prepared. So if I know we have a certain amount of percentage of patients, I'm going to just use this example, with unknown hepatitis statuses, and they want to be like, well, why do you have 8% with unknown? And I'd be like, because 3 of the 8% is the same patient, or this, that, and another. So it's like, the answers is already there. So when you come prepared like that, then it's like, oh, they don't give you that much, you know, that much slack. But you do. You always have to over-prepare and be ready for the ones that want to question whatever you're saying.
I don't have a problem with people questioning me, because guess what? I'm the kind of person that's going to question you, too. So it's like, I love those people when you have a meeting and you say, well, what about this? How about this? When is that? Like, to me, that don't bother me, because guess what? I'm prepared for that. I'm ready to answer all your questions. Anything that you have and you want to know, I'm ready to answer it. So it's like, come on. I get mad when you don't ask the questions. I be saying, well, shit, I read all this stuff. Ain't nobody asked about that.
Exactly. So I don't get mad either. But even when I'm precepting somebody, I be like, make sure you have this data right here. And so there's nothing for them to say. You're meeting to go real smooth. But once you start that, I don't know, let me look into it. I have to get back to you. Then they start questioning you. You know, they start doubting your credibility. So you always have to go
30 and 3.
Well, I'm not gonna lie, because of what I do, I feel like when I'm walking to a home, I am an African American woman. They question me from the door anyway. They always question me. Maybe I shouldn't feel that way, but I do. So it's like, I have to be prepared to answer whatever it is you want to ask me. And even the off questions, I gotta have some kind of response. I have to say something, because it's like, I feel like I'm questioning from the door. So,
yeah.
I know some people
and we're meeting with, like, very important people. I'm meeting with people from the C-suite, you know, the CFO. I need to know. I need to know my regulations. I need to know my contracts. I need to be able to spit it out. And then I'll say, contractually, you know, or main complaint. Like, it's certain keywords you have to say, because they'll try to scoop you in to do stuff, and it's like, you gotta be on your A game and have something to back it up. Like I say, contractually, that's not something we can, you know? And, or I say, that's out of our, from a compliance perspective, I can't audit your record, you know? So, you always gotta be a step ahead of everybody.
I do feel that, because I usually have to be.
I think so.
I have to.
And you know, we all got our little hood side, but we get real professional and they challenge you. But they stop challenging once they know you are on point. So you always have to be on point.
You do always have to be on point, and you always have to have your documentation.
To meetings together, and then he'll get asked a question, and he said, well, you know what? Well, Ms. Lattimore L knows more about this than I. So he's turning over to her. Like, I have to be ready for stuff like that. And he does it to me all the time, because he knew, and he don't know what the hell he's doing anyway. Mm-hmm. So I have to be ready for that. So I'm like I said, I feel like I always over prepare. I'm always over prepared for every meeting that I go to. And the funny part is, I am literally 2 minutes before I walk into a meeting, you can find me in the corner reading up on my pre-read. Trust me. Because I have to be. Like, I don't ever want to be caught out there. Because I can remember a couple times I've caught out there at meetings and I'm like, okay, that ain't gonna happen to me again. Like, I can't let it happen to me again. Because it made me look crazy. Because I wasn't prepared. And I mean, that had to be about 15, 20 years ago. But guess what? I don't do that shit no more.
But that's why I like seeing it.
I'm ready.
They come to you with it automatically puts you in a defense. So what I do is, when I know something happened or something came up, they my first call, like to the doctors or to whoever, and I'm like, this is what happened, we short staff, I'll let you know how I'm making out throughout finding staffing, as opposed to them calling and saying, oh, you don't have enough staff today. There's a different reaction. It's like it's a psychological game you have to play when you're in a leadership role. It's a psych game.
Psych or chess, yep.
All right. It's crazy, but you know what? I guess everybody has their way of dealing with it, in our respective jobs, because I do it every freaking day. I get tired of being on the defense all the time, but, you know, it is what it is. Because technically, at my job, I'm a
sick. I had to talk to the
doctor. What'd you say?
Yeah, I had a doc call me at 9:20. And so I'm like, okay, so I had to talk to him, I had to talk to the nurse, I had to get back to the doctor. I'll call the nurse back later. But it's like, I don't know. There's a lot of personalities that you have to deal with, especially in my industry. And then, it's not easy. It's not easy. But I like it. I love it, actually, what I do. And, you know, my main focus is the patients. And I always say, as long as our patients are being taken care of, then we're good.
What's on our topic?
So while we was talking a little bit about the book, I'm sure y'all heard about this book, Rage, that Bob Woodard has wrote, and is set to release, I think, this week. We heard about the topic of the coronavirus, but also he was on record as saying basically he protected the that Saudi crown prince who had that the United States columnist murdered, basically helped him to avoid those charges. He's on a book as actually saying that. This happened like around 2 years ago. At first they couldn't find him, and then he was dead. Yeah, my only thing is, when I heard that, and I just heard that this morning on MSNBC.
You're breaking up.
Oh, I don't know why, but when I heard that this morning on MSNBC, I was kind of shocked at that he was basically bragging about that. And then my thing is this, you bragged about all these inappropriate things to this man, Bob Woodard, and gave him tapes. Like, really, what did you think he was going to do? Baby, can you stop that? What did you think he was going to do with that information? Like, what else? You knew he was writing a book. Like, you gave it right to him, like a dummy. I'm glad you did, but...
That was the purpose of the tape. He sat down with Trump, and he did, I think, over 18 interviews, because he knew he was writing a book. But the funny part is, the crazy thing about Donald Trump is a businessman. I think that's what everybody seems to forget. He's not a politician. He is a businessman. So he is used to being able to say what he wants to say when he wants to do, because when he runs his own business, he's the boss. The difference between him being the president of the United States is that you're not the boss of the United States. You're our figurehead, but you're not the boss. And I don't think he's ever learned how to switch his mind off from being a businessman into being the president of the United States. There's certain you're running your own business. And the funny part is he sat down with Bob Woodard and did these tapes with him. But what I don't understand is, like you said, how could you feel so comfortable to tell him these things? Do you think nobody's going to tell it? You know somebody's going to tell it. So, but that to me, but that just shows you his mind frame. I don't think he really cares. He knew he lied. He admitted it. He said, I downplayed it. I downplayed
Wentz
it all the
just
time.
Fumbled. They got the ball back. They about to score another touchdown.
But that's what I'm trying to understand. What was the, like, how did, what did you, as a businessman, how did you think that, what did you think that this was going to help?
Bottom line is, technically, the book wasn't supposed to come out now. The book is not supposed to come out now.
Okay.
So I guess, I was thinking maybe he thought that this information would come after his presidency was over or whatever. But the bottom line is, he decided to bring the book out now. He decided to push up the date for the book. But the funny part is, I don't understand why you would tell somebody something and you think that they're not going to tell it. They're going to tell it. But to me, in my mind, I don't think he cares. I don't think he really cares.
He does. How much stuff he got caught on? I mean, the stuff about groping women and just grabbing them by the cuticles and stuff like that. Like, it doesn't matter. It didn't change anything. Everything that comes out about him, It does not have an impact on
whatever
happens to him. He doesn't care.
He just does what he wants to do. They're
going to hold him accountable for nothing. Yep. The bottom line is, with him being the president, what is supposed to happen? They can't really touch him right now. Not really. The only thing you can do to back at him is to vote him out of office. Because there's nothing else you can really do.
Exactly. So that's why you're saying, He's not the boss. He's the president. He's still the boss. You know why? Because there's no repercussions or consequences for his actions. So he's going to do what he wants to do, regardless.
How long was Obama in office?
Yes, he can to a certain degree. But you know what? The sad part is, that's why everybody within the sound of our voice should be out there on November 3rd vote, because that's the only way. That's the only way to end his reign. If you want to get rid of him, get out there and vote.
And I would urge the Latino community to please wake up, because right now you're his target. And I heard him make some very derogatory and racist remarks this morning when he visited you in Nevada. I think that was yesterday. I was appalled, and I'm not Latino, but I felt embarrassed for him. So I would urge you to get out, you know, do some research and make the right decision.
What? Yeah. I ain't talking about Latinx people. I'm talking about black people, brown people, Asian people. I don't give a damn what race you are.
I'm singling them out because right now, the reason why I say that, because right now that's his focus. That's his focus because that's where Biden is behind that. So basically, wherever his opponent is not high in the polls, that's what he's targeting, and right now that's Latino people. But of course,
I tell you what, I don't give a damn what race you are. If you smart and you don't like him, you get out there and you vote.
Definitely.
Because guess what? I can say to white people, if you don't like him, get out there and vote his ass off. At this point, I don't even know if race, in my opinion, race is like, at this point, if you are offended by him, I don't care what race you are. If you want to get rid of him, get out there and vote. Get out there and vote and get him out, because that's the only way to stop him. Get him out. Get his ass out of office, period. And the funny part is, as you always say, I don't see nobody talk about, damn, he's there for another 4 years and he shouldn't be there. If you didn't vote, don't say nothing. If you're not going to go out there and vote, don't open your mouth. Don't say a word.
Because if you don't vote for him, you're voting for him. If you don't vote, you're voting for him.
So, you know what's funny? I want to tell Kanye West to his dumb black ass down, too, because
I'm voting for Kanye.
Please don't even say that on air.
I'm voting for Kanye.
Like, what is the point? Like, is that enough? We're trying to get black people to vote. Like, why are you out there with your foolishness? Ain't nobody taking you serious. I know I'm not. But it's like, why are you even out there? Is it for a distraction? Like, what is it for? Like, what's the point? Like, what's the issue with him? It's like, go somewhere and have a seat. Like, this is serious. And you out here playing games like somebody really going to vote you in and make you the president of the United States. Like, come on. But you know, he's not right. That's my take with a grain of salt. Yeah, but this is the whole point. I don't understand how come if you know somebody has a mental health issue, why do you want him to do the dumb shit that he do? Like why you let him do? It's like, you don't have enough people around you to tell you not to do something or please don't do it, or just like they'll stop you from doing anything. Why can't they stop him from doing the bullshit that he do? It's like, even no, when he went off on Kim Kardashian and her mother when he had this little mental breakdown, he could see her back and she was like, mental health is serious. Mental health is a thing. It's serious. Which I understand it is serious. But then again, you turn around and you right back at his church service 2 weeks later. Like, nobody says, listen, you can't do that. The funny part is I've known people that they talked about T.I. went to go talk to him for a while. Steve Harvey went to talk to him seriously for a minute to try to get him to cool out and stuff like that.
But he may need some professional help.
Why? He be doing the shit that he do and nobody says anything about it. It's like, boy, go sit down.
Because he's Kanye and he has money and he rules the world to them. You know? If that's why you need somebody, like we can tell, like, the way we say if we talking to our mates and we be like, Jeff was wrong. Or if I did something out of pocket, y'all would be like, you was wrong for that. You know? And
right. Nope,
everybody, like, they sniff his dirty draws. Nobody come up against him and say, you wasn't right. Now, maybe if his mother was alive, she would be the one that could, you know, tell him he's doing the dumb shit. But nobody else is going to do that. They on his bandwagon. They're not going to do it.
I just personally think it's a disgrace. Kanye, go sit your dumb black ass down somewhere and go take a damn psychotic drug so you can get right.
Oh, no.
Go sit down somewhere. Like, no offense. It's like, I like you and I like your music, but I just want you to have a seat right now. Like, Sam, but now ain't the time for it. Ain't nobody got time for you right now. Nobody has time for your games right now. Go have a seat.
Is him and Jay-Z still friends?
Not that I don't think so.
Okay, because I know probably he would be one of the ones that could tell him to sit his dumb ass down. But I'm glad they're not friends, because then that means that Jay-Z is equally as crazy. So
they had a falling out a couple of years ago.
I think we all have friends that are a little crazy. We all have them. We got some friends that go off a little bit and they should say and stuff like that. But the funny part is, like you said, most time if you got a friend and your friend is saying some real dumb shit, you be like, yo, you need to cool out, like, or you need to relax a little bit. Or if I gotta distance myself from you because I don't want people to think I'm on that same shit you on, then I'll do that. Yeah. And I'm just surprised that nobody in his camp that says, yo, like, you really need to relax yourself. You need to just,
they're not,
you know, like,
not.
Be easy.
Because they in his camp. That's the thing.
I don't know if they're really friends. They may just be, like she said, in his camp.
A real friend or somebody that I mean, even his wife, but she's equally as stupid. So you can't even say nothing about that, because he needs someone that's not gonna benefit from anything that he has, that can consider themselves his real friend and say, that's some dumb shit.
Yeah, like, relax on it. Relax. I mean, friendships that I had to literally walk away from because my friend was on some dumb shit, and you be saying, look, I don't want no parts of that, because you was like acting like a fool, or like you're doing something that I don't agree with. I've had friendships that I had to walk away from, even if it was temporarily. You go say, you know, I just can't fuck with you, man, because you tripping. And it's like, and I think it's sad that you have all that money, and money, even though you have all this money, you don't have a true friend in the world. You don't have nobody to tell you when you're doing something crazy.
Well, I can't say what happened. I can't. He did used to have true friendships, but he's destroyed them. And one of them was the whole Jay-Z thing. You know, you can't get mad just because somebody doesn't want you over to your house and you plan a play date. They just, they may not be like, feel like being bothered during that time, and it's nothing against you. Like, no, I'm just going to chill out today. But you can't get mad and then start shouting it all over the airwaves when
you know what I mean, y'all are of celebrity status, but then you let the world into y'all personal problems. That's inappropriate. So he did used to have real friends. He destroyed that relationship.
Yeah. Well, I still think it has a lot to do with his mental health status. Because once again, we as black people, you know how we do when somebody in our family is crazy or we got that crazy friend. Instead of sending your crazy friend to them insane asylum or giving them 302s like we should do, we always go, oh, he'll be all right. We'll send him to church or we'll pray for him. Or he all right, he in the back room, just lock the door. Whatever. I don't know why we do that with people with mental health issues. Even, you know, that kind of brings me to, even though this is not our topic. That's the whole Tamar Braxton thing. With her getting into this fight with her boyfriend and all this stuff like that. He came out and straight up said she has mental health issues. And you know what the funny part is? I don't know nothing about Tamar. I don't really get into her like that. But guess what? It don't surprise me that he said that about her. I'm not shocked, surprised with that at all. And the funny part
is, I wasn't surprised at that either, but I was surprised at the way that it came out. Because to me, it seemed like he clout chasing. If she got the mental health issues, okay. You was with her for how long? Mm-hmm. You was about to marry her. This just came out. Why are you doing interviews about it? You once loved me, but now you're doing interviews about my mental health problems?
Because she's trying to get restraining orders on him and all this other stuff. See, it's turned into something else. Just like we said earlier, when you have money, there are a lot of people who will be around you, and they will keep your secrets. They'll keep your secrets for you and stuff like that, because I think Tamar Braxton has had mental issues for a long time. Because guess what? Banks one time said she had mental problems. She had issues. But they kind of downplayed that too. So what I'm saying is, I don't think that he's saying it to get back at her. I don't think he should have come out and said it the way that he said it. But I think it's true. I think it's true. But I mean, if you try to kill yourself and you're doing all this crazy foolishness.
Of course,
and stuff like
yeah.
That,
but don't, what I'm saying is this. He once claimed to love this woman. I don't think that the interviews were necessary. I just don't
know. But if my husband ever came out and tried to get a restraining order on me or get me locked up and stuff like that, and I felt like I need to come out and say, hey, this motherfucker's crazy, I'd say it. I wouldn't have a problem saying it. That don't mean I don't love him, but I just need y'all to know. If you're trying to tear me down and call the cops on me and get me locked up, and you're the one with the mental issues.
I thought that he was trying to get the restraining order because he said she attacked him.
He was trying to get one, but she put one out on him first. I think their problems encompass a lot. I think it encompasses the fact that she makes a lot of money. Number two, she has this new show out. Number three, I think she's had issues for a long time. And number four, it to me it's a domestic thing too. So when you're in a relationship with somebody, I think to a certain degree you have to keep your partner's secrets to a certain degree. You understand what I'm saying? Like, we don't know certain things about our partners that we ain't gonna go out and tell everybody on the street. So I'm sure he knew she might have been cuckoo for a long time, but it wasn't the time to say it. And like I said, I don't even know if it's the appropriate time to say it now. But I think what happens is when relationships hit the fan, a lot of stuff comes out. A whole lot of stuff comes out. And the funny part is, I think people start questioning Tamar's mental health, even when she had that intervention with Inyala Van Zandt and her family, and she went off on Inyala for no reason. And just, I just think Tamar has had mental issues for a long time, and I think nobody's talking about it. I think she's been suffering from mental illness for the longest time. As a matter of fact, I don't know if y'all watch this show. I watch it every now and again. That show called Black Love. This show comes on the own channel called Black Love, and what they do is they sit down with African-American couples of all different kinds. Some of them be stars, some of them don't be stars. And they sit down and they talk about different topics regarding a relationship. And I know last night I happened to be watching it, and they were talking about what happens when you're in a relationship and the person has, or they have, depression or mental illness going on. And it was really interesting to sit back and listen to other couples talk about stuff like that, because this one couple was a man and a wife. The husband, he had severe depression. And the wife was a nurse, and she was saying how he was suffering, and I didn't even know it. She said he put up such a front, because you know how black men are. Black men don't like to talk about a lot of stuff. And she said he was suffering, and she said the only way I knew he had issues, and she said one day I called him on the phone, and he told me his chest was tight, and he had a pain in his arm. She said, I'm thinking he's having a heart attack. She said, I said, listen, I'm on my way to work. I need to come outside. So she said she convinced him to get in her car. And she said they went to the hospital together. And she said they gave him all these tests and stuff like that. And come to find out, he wasn't having no heart issues. The problem was he was so depressed. And he had anxiety really, 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 really bad. And she was saying how even when he got diagnosed with anxiety, they didn't even tell the family, his immediate family. She said, I didn't want to tell his mom and his sisters and brothers and stuff like that. Because she said, because I knew it would be instant judgment. Because she said, because that's how it is. Usually when, you know, something happens, people come out and they judge you. And she said, so he was on his medication and seeing a therapist 5 months before we even let his family in on it. And she's like, by that time, he had somewhat gotten himself together and stuff like that. But, I mean, that show, maybe y'all can look it up on demand. But I know the episode that I just saw last night was a very good one. It's called Black Love. And they were just talking about, they used to sit down and talk to black couples on different issues. But last night's issues was about, like, mental health and depression and anxiety and stuff like that. How you deal with it within a relationship. And I know one time they had a topic about, which is very interesting to me, because me and Damon sat down and watched it. It was about couples who have somebody, one of the people in the relationship get sick. Like, what do you do? How do you handle it? Like, you know, what happens? Like, how do you handle it? How do you tell the children? How do you know? Like, how do you tell the other parts of the family? Should you tell? Do you tell? It was very interesting. Y'all might want to look that show up. It's very good. It's called Black Love.
Very interesting.
It's very good.
Alright, let's get back to our topic. See what we talk about. Oh, just a quick tidbit. So, Michael Bloomberg did give $1 million toward campaign efforts to Biden.
I read that. He gave $1 million out of his pockets. But it's basically for them to concentrate on the state of Florida.
Yep, Florida mostly.
But Biden hopes to win. He has to win the state of Florida. If he don't want Florida, he's not going to win. So he gave $1 million out of his own pocket. Oh, Bloomberg, give up that cash.
Yeah, they want him out too.
Because there are certain, believe it or not, you know, Democrats lost in Pennsylvania last year to Trump, which is usually unusual because Pennsylvania is a severely Democratic state. But guess what? Trump won it last time. He won Pennsylvania by a very slim margin, but he did win. So there are certain states that they're trying to focus on, like Florida. I think Minnesota is one of them as well. Mm-hmm. As well as Pennsylvania, and it's another one. I think it's 4 or 5 of them that they have to win. If they don't win them, then he won't win. So shout out to Bloomberg for giving him that extra $1 million to help his campaign, because he needed it.
But it sure don't be rigged. And I'm sick of this. People calling me, making sure that I send in my vote. And I said, no, I'm going to an actual poll. And she was like, oh, you can mail it in. I said, I don't want to mail it in. I'm going to an actual poll. She was like, do you know if there's one in your area? I said, I don't care where it's at. I said, but I'm not mailing my vote in. I'm going to an actual poll. She was like, well, it's secure.
Why would she ask you, was it one in your area? Of course it's one in your area. Hell, if you
she
live
was giving you the third damn degree.
Yeah,
well, I know. I end up hanging up on her. Yeah. Because I'm like, I'm not messing with my boo. I told my mom, too. I said, don't mail it in. Because then you got to worry about if it got there and they all, like, send it this way. Say, no, take your ass the same way we voted during the primary. You can take your ass and go vote during the regular election. And that's all 52 fake out, the setup to keep you, you know, to rig it again. They just trying to, no, I'm going. I want to say I pulled the trigger. I signed in and I did my part that way. I'm not mailing nothing in.
All right then.
I mean, I agree. I'm going to cast my vote. I won't be mailing mine, and I'll just go around the corner and put my phone with
them. I don't care if I have to drive to Ohio.
That's cool.
Awesome. I'm going somewhere to a polling place.
I know, I sound like it.
Even though they just lost.
Shut up. Did they?
I told you they were losing.
Alright, so the Eagles lost. Didn't I tell you?
Oh,
Okay, so moving on.
L Boogie is a diehard Eagles fan. That's my man. I love him because he represents Philly to the fullest. He hurt. He crushed.
Yeah, I'm with him with that one. WTF. Okay, so, wait a second. There are Florida wildfire fires? I didn't know that.
You can't really hear about the Florida wildfires. You can see Florida. The half of Florida is on fire.
No.
We ain't tell you.
I knew about the West Coast too. I didn't hear about Florida.
Florida has been involved as well, but the West Coast is really bad. I know out in Los Angeles and stuff, they showed on the news the other day about out in Los Angeles, it was 11 o'clock in the morning, and it looked like it was like 7 o'clock at night. That's how dark it was. And the whole
and it stayed like that for like 24 hours.
Orange, it was crazy. What I don't understand about the whole wildfire thing is, you know, every year on the West Coast, they have wildfires every year because it's very dry out there and stuff like that.
That's not the West Coast. That's Florida, right?
This might be silly because, I mean, how come they can't, I don't think they'll be able to prevent the wildfires, but how come, you know how they have the planes flying over and wetting the fires and stuff like that? How come they can't do that 2 or 3 weeks in advance of the fire to make sure the ground is wet so it don't, you know, so it don't combust? Like, I don't understand how that works. Maybe y'all know more than I do. But if y'all know y'all have every year, it's like, how come y'all can't go out there and pre-spray? Like, spray the damn ground, make sure it's wet so it won't catch on fire. Like, I don't understand how
I'm
that
still
works.
Surprised about the Florida thing, because when we get my babies out there in college.
It's not bad like it is on the West Coast, but they have to have a couple wild fires. It's not as bad as out in L.A. and stuff like that.
But I agree. If you know it's coming, spray it.
Just wants to be on spray. Every time he go, he keeps jumping up on my lap. Stay high and get down.
But
they found started them.
Who? Where
yeah.
at?
Yeah, a couple of them was arson.
In Florida?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. One in Florida, and I think it was two in L.A. that somebody actually started.
He looked good and crazy, too.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, he looked messed up. He was crazy.
They said it was like...
That burned?
Huh?
It was that. How many acres that burned?
Like 5 million.
Damn.
Mm. Not 5 million.
5 million. Alright, I need to find out where this is at in Florida, y'all.
Oh. 5 million acres.
Oh.
He is in Miami, in Fort Lauderdale.
I know, it looks like they've been having a good time. I've been checking it out on, you know, when she posts the pictures.
Yeah. All right, what else we got?
Okay, so, wait a second. Okay, before we get to entertainment, let's handle our business here. These virtual school challenges. And there was a COVID outbreak in Michigan.
Acres. For your listeners.
Yeah, it's a college. One of the colleges out there, every all students are quarantined.
Oh damn.
So they have everyone on quarantine because of the outbreak, and it's not looking good. So all I wanna say is I hope they don't call for me to take my ass back up to Redding. Because that trip, all that stuff was a piece of work. And I feel like they shouldn't have let them go back prematurely, but nonetheless, they're there. They have these little things, I don't know if I mentioned it last week, but they're called like study cubes or something,
mm-hmm.
where it's just room and it's like only 4 chairs and they can go in there and study as opposed to being like out in the library and things like that. So I guess they're taking extra precautions, but this virtual school, I'm going to tell you, I feel like it's a full-time job for parents because, one, you got to make sure the kids is up and logged in and ready. Now, your daughter, Q, might be a little different because she's older, but this one here, I got to keep making sure he's stable
because he's laying in the bed on the laptop. Next thing you know, he's asleep again. And then it's all these assignments that you want us to do, like to make sure they're done. And I'm like, I don't feel as though I should have to. Like, I shouldn't have to log on to Google Class and look up this form and look up that form and make sure this doc is done. That's more work for me. That's what the hell they go to school for.
Let me ask you a question, though. With him not being able to get up and stuff like that, him laying, like, my whole thing is this. I think what has to happen, you might have to set out a certain designated space for him to sit when he does his classwork. But maybe him, I mean, maybe he's going to class, he's going to work, maybe he's going to sit down and relax, whatever. Like, I had to set old girl up at a desk. I bought a desk, I got her together. Like, she had a desk, matter of fact, she had the desk right now. I don't play with her hands. I don't play. You're going to do this work and you're going to get it done.
Work. However, it's still a lot of work. I mean, he is only 11 years old. So it's like trying to keep the attention span of an 11-year-old. And he's like, he starts, at the end of class, he starts doing dumb shit. You know? It's like bouncing off the wall. Like, because they don't have...
Where she at?
Let me see Selena.
She on her desk right now. Sit your ass in and get it done.
Right. You get it.
I told y'all, like, that little boy was here the other day. I can't move. My mom said I can't move, but she ain't playing with me. And I can't move. And she was like, well, you can go on your break. She was like, no, I can't. I can't move. Now, I ain't thinking right. That you got to scare with somebody. But no, I think I know it's very hard. I know it's very hard. But you know what? You got to let kids know, listen, you got to do this. Like, even if I'm here, even if I'm not here, you're going to do it. You got to do it.
Of bringing this up. The point is, it's a lot of work for me. I need folders for myself.
They're putting more pressure on the parents, I think.
I print stuff out for me, to checklists, to make sure this is done, that's done. I'm like, come on, that's crazy. I shouldn't have to do that. You know, I have to do it, but I mean, it's more work for me.
It is. But you know what? I guess, like with everything else, it's like an adjustment thing. We got to figure out how we got to get it done and just do it, because if it's regarding their education, you really don't have much of a choice. It's like, I got to do this stuff because I need my kids to be educated and I need them, you know, to get the work done or whatever. So, yeah.
It's a whole different ball game when they're young. And I'm telling you, I don't envy you with young children at all. Lady T, y'all know, like my cousin Tanya, like sister, she was telling me how hard it is to even, you know, get her daughter to focus. And she was like, it's hard. She was like, plus I gotta go to work and I'll be tired. It's a struggle to have her get up in the morning, and then we be trying to do the work. She don't want to do it, throwing a tantrum. So I'm just like, oh my God.
Mm. And then the teacher, like, cameras on. All right, fine. Yeah, the cameras on. But it's still like, and then they send you an email that's like 3 pages if you print it off with a man. Yeah, this. It's like, come on. I understand y'all trying to make the best of it or whatever, but I mean, do I have to like it? No, and I don't. Do I have to do it? Of course. But it's a pain in the ass.
I agree.
It's a
lot of extra stuff. I know, because like I said, they send email. You write them emails extra long. You be like, well, damn, how long is this? You got to read all the emails, make sure that you electronically sign all the documents and make sure that they're back, because my daughter has a lot of AP classes. A lot of her stuff has to be approved, and it's like, it's a lot.
And see, my thing with the emails and with the even the papers that they send home, like I used to tell, I think I went through it, I filled out when my daughters were in, same names, I never forget. I filled out all those forms that they sent home in the beginning, both times. And I let that teacher know, this won't happen again. The next year, they sent it home, like, since I had to do two at one time, no. See the previous ones. All the information is the same. See the other ones. I'm not filling out. I don't like reading through a whole bunch of stuff. send me something and get to the point. Like, I don't need a long, drawn-out novel. My famous words that I always say to the twins, let's not make a career out of it. Let's not make a career out of you sitting home shitting me reading it. Sit at home, right? Get it to the point, because I don't like to read through a whole lot of bullshit. I just don't.
That's what it is. I feel sorry for the parents who had to find alternative measures for their children. Like, whereas we have the luxury from working at home when we want to, there's a lot of people that can't work from home. They got to go into the office. What the hell do they do with their kids and stuff like that? It's a lot.
Yeah.
We had to adjust her schedule so she could still work. Luckily, we was able to. And it's a lot. And I'm like, shit, I can find a private school, or he won't go to Catholic school. But I'm like, we need something so he can. I feel bad for the kids though. Mainly them, because it's like they don't have an outlet. They like getting up like one morning, and he was up and logged in before I even woke up. So that's fine, like he'll do that. But then it's like,
that's so funny that he won't go to Catholic school now, because he used to go to Catholic school.
I know. No, he not. So I even tried to find an Islamic. One I found was only 6 kids in the whole school, so I said, no, that's not going to work.
Mm. Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
No.
Mm-mm.
So, that's my bitch session for this week. I'm sure I have another one next week. Do we have any comments?
No, we don't, but we do got some more good topics that we about to hit right quick. Oh, wait a second. The court shows got virtual guests, now they need to stop.
Yeah, I saw
that.
People doing the other day. It was like Judge Mathis, and it was like 2 people, the litigants, and they had like maybe 6 people in the whole audience, and they was like this far apart. Like, they was like far apart. I was like, dang. It was funny looking.
No, people's court, the plaintiffs and the defendants are like on Zoom or something.
Mm-hmm.
They like this.
Yeah, ain't nobody watching y'all. You all watching that game.
It's bad enough, like divorce court, the audience. So the litigants on people's court, they're on video chat. And the court court. But I wonder when they come back on the week after next. So I wonder how that's going to be.
Hmm.
Probably something crazy like they got going on now. But you know what the funny part is? You know what Tim and X tells me? Where is the will, there's a way. You got to do something. You just got to figure out how to do it. You got to like make the best out of it. And I think that's in the world. You got to make it work no matter what it is. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Make it happen, Captain.
You know. Yep. But that was funny to me when I saw that this week. But you can hear him watching football.
Okay. Okay, so listen. Fresh Prince of Bel-Air had their 30-year anniversary. I can't believe it's been 30 years.
He said he redoing the show.
They're actually talking about doing a
new show,
some kind of program where they all get back together. I don't know how they're going to do it.
Noel said he's doing an extension show.
And the reason that it was so important is
called
because he had like a picture of the whole crew. And y'all know that when the first Aunt Viv left, she was on very bad terms, and she was saying how she hated Will Smith and she would never speak to him again. He actually had a picture with her, like that he had a picture with talking to her, and he said they kind of got back together and had a conversation and talked about what happened or whatever, so I guess she's not mad anymore. I don't know how they're going to work her into this, you know, I don't know if they're going to have a special.
She's probably, not the other one, because I like the original Viv anyway.
I do too.
But the thing is, what are they going to say?
I don't know.
I'm sure they'll do some kind of memoriam to him or whatever. But like I said, it was very interesting because, like I said, he sat down and he actually talked to the original Aunt Viv, because when she left, it was on horrible terms. Like, they hated one another. She hated Will Smith, and Will Smith was not digging her either. So, I mean, they got back together. They had a conversation. They didn't tell you what they said in their conversation. They just had pictures posted of him and her talking, and they were laughing. So, I guess everything's cool now. So, I don't know how they're going to work the show or what they're going to actually do. Maybe they might do, like, a retrospective of the show or something like that. I don't think they're going to get together and, like, try to make, like, a Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, like, the new version. But they just was talking about how it's been 30 years. It don't even seem like it's been that long. So I remember when it first came on.
I'd rather them just do, like, snippets. Like, the best, look at Toto.
Heckin' a fool. Bow to the side, girl. Say hi.
Yeah.
Y'all see her little, she got a little name tag. It got a little Chewbacca on it. Because that's what she looked like. Okay, get down, because you acting crazy. And I don't have anything.
Kayla ordered tag for Angel that looked like
the license tag? Yeah, I saw those too.
Mm-hmm. I seen those too. Those are cute. Those are good. These animals. Well, I want to know what these animals are going to do and how they going to act when we all go back to work and our asses ain't handled. What they going to do then? Because I think they've gotten so used to us being here now that that's what they're used to. And it's like, I wonder how they want to act. Like, when things go back to normal and everybody get up and go back to work, this guy.
I'm almost even ashamed to say this, but I actually put on the Proud Family for Coco, and she watches it.
Ain't nothing wrong with it. Listen,
tell other people to cut off the TV before they leave.
He said, listen, he said, and I tell other people to turn off the TV when they leave. But we'll keep on Proud Family for Coco. Listen, she be watching all in alertness. I was like, I can't believe you like this.
She is a mess with her little stuff.
These animals is too much.
Yeah. All right, what else we got?
Okay, so I saw this on TV, and I wasn't too much digging it. I saw the trailer for Real Housewives of Salt Lake. I mean, I'll give it a spin and see what happens when it comes on, but they just didn't grab my attention.
Me either.
You know, I don't know the real.
Well, I know you don't watch it. You didn't grab yours either.
You know what's funny? This is gonna sound real bad, but I'm gonna say it anyway.
Uh-oh.
If they ain't black, I ain't really interested. I hate to say that. It's the truth though.
Now see, I don't feel that way because I like the Beverly Hills.
I don't watch the Real Housewives of Orange County. I do not watch the Real Housewives of Dallas. I do not watch the Real Housewives of wherever the hell else they at. If they ain't in Atlanta,
and see, I don't really care so much about the race or the color, but it has to be an interesting.
I used to watch the Jersey one.
I like the Jersey.
I used to watch the Jersey one because they were like Italians or whatever. But like the Real Housewives of Salt Lake City, like I ain't interested.
I'm not either. So it didn't grab me. None of the people seem interesting.
That seems like it'd be like some sister wives.
Some of them are Mormons, so.
Wow.
Have y'all ever been to Utah?
No.
No.
I don't have no desire to go.
We got two offices in Utah.
Mm.
Utah, we got one in Ogden, and we got one in Salt Lake City. It is the weirdest vibe ever.
I don't even think they have, usually when I associate with places I want to go, y'all know me, what's their specialty food? I don't think there is one.
Weirdest vibe ever. When you go into the office, I'm gonna tell you, and mind you, you're right, most of them be Mormon, but what's weird is, first of all, it ain't that many black people in Utah, period. Okay, now you might see one every now and again. So when I go into the office, I think out of that whole Ogden office, I think we have like maybe like 52-53 employees. Out of them 53 employees, we might have maybe four black ones. Well, what's weird though, when you go in there, the vibe is just so weird. Like, they're super, you know, see people that's like super, super polite to the point where you're like, y'all must be fucking fake. Like, they're extra, extra polite. They're super nice. And whenever I come to the Ogden office, they want to do like the potluck lunches where everybody bring in something. And they want to eat. They give me a very step, like Sapphire said, they give me a very step for wives type. And all of us, they kind of dress alike. Everybody has on like a white button up shirt. baby having a little dress. You know, like, dress, you know how it's funny, like, it, up here, like, with our age, most of the time, if you're going to wear a dress, you need to wear a super long dress, you know, like a really long maxi skirt, or you wear a super short dress. You know what I'm saying? We don't really wear dresses that come down, like, halfway our calf. That's how they dress. They all dress in the dresses that come, like, halfway down their calf, and they all got on their little new pantyhose and they little black patent leather shoes. Like, it's weird. Like, is it they just... They just give me a really strange. They nice though. I can't say that they're nice. They're not nice because every time I go, they treat me nice. But it's like, it's just weird. When I tell you, I be flying in and out of there. Like I don't even. I try not to even spend the night there. I'm like, I gotta go. I got that's gonna be something. This shit gonna be. What's that movie? What was that movie called? Where they was trying to kill all the black people in the damn horror movie?
Oh, get out! Yeah.
I'm like, I gotta get out of here. I can't stay. When I fly into Ogden, I fly in and I fly out the very same day. I don't
feel damn, it. No sitting at night, huh?
It's weird. And then, like I said, they're nice, though. Don't get me wrong. They're very nice. And you know what? It's beautiful because they're mountains. All you see is mountains. It's beautiful. Like, mountains and, like, open areas. It's really pretty, but it's just weird. It's very, very weird. And I was asking my driver one day, I was like, why do I keep seeing, like, all these black SUVs, like, driving around? They, like, blacked out SUVs. He said, oh, that's the, what did he call it? The, oh, he had a weird name for it. It wasn't the prayer squad. He was saying how, like, a lot of the Mormon churches in that area, they don't like outsiders. So when they see a car that they don't recognize, he said, they just do, like, these local patrols. Like, the people from the church just be riding around to see what's going on in the neighborhood. Like, it's weird. It's very strange.
Mm.
I was like,
yeah, because people do have the right to come and visit whenever they want. You're not the darn police.
We are, like, very strange. They're very nice, though. They're super nice. Like, so nice to the point you're like, come on, y'all. Like, y'all can't be this nice. Like, they're very, very nice. They're very hospitable. But it's just very strange.
Yeah, I have no desire. And
the black people that's there, they don't act black. They, like, they almost, like, black on the outside, white on the inside. It's weird. I don't know. It's very strange. Very, very strange. So when I seen the whole Real Housewives of Salt Lake City and I seen the previews, I was like, okay, I'm going to be watching that. It's just weird to me.
It didn't grab my attention. Nobody on there seemed interesting to me, so. Mm-mm. Hated it. Sorry, Andy.
Me too. That's what I won't be tuning into.
Me either. So the Kooligan Gang, the founder dies.
Yeah, Kevin Bell. Only 58 years old. I think his name
Bell.
Robert Bell.
He said Kevin
Robert
Bell.
Yeah.
He said Robert. Kevin Bell.
Robert Bell. Okay.
Yeah. Robert Bell.
Robert Bell. I'm sorry.
No, Robert Bell.
She right.
It was two brothers, Richard and Robert. Richard died a couple years ago. Robert.
Who
just
had
died.
The thick mustache? That's
you
singing
know,
the
about Kool and the Gang that I didn't know. They said Kool and the Gang is the longest running band, R&B band in the history of the world. They've been touring and they've been they never broke up. So they're still going strong. So it's like, oh wow, they've been going on. They Kool and the Gang been out for over 40 something years.
Wow.
I was like, okay.
Crazy.
But we all.
Yeah, we all know that. My dad used to play their music, so.
Oh, we all celebrate good times. Yeah, he had some good songs.
He did.
Yeah, they did.
Okay, this next story really did fool us all. We talked a little bit about this last week about Niecy Nash and her new marriage to a woman. Because I think we all said we really didn't even know that she was gay. And she was saying it has nothing to do with gender. Okay, when I hear stuff like this and, you know, it has nothing to do with gender, you have to be realistic. You know, I'm not what do they call those things? One of those, I'm not a homophobe, but nothing like that. You know, don't have a problem with gay people. I absolutely do love gay men. I mean, they have the best fashion
what
sense.
What the
fuck? Do I'm sorry, but they just do. But on her, I don't see how you could say that it doesn't have a gender. When I don't understand her saying that because they have different parts.
I didn't understand either. I was reading the whole interview and it's very strange to me. I think what she's trying to do is downplay
what happened, because she was saying that people were saying to her, oh, were you gay all this time, and then you just decided to come out. She said, I wasn't anything. She says, I just love who I love. She was like, I love my wife's spirit. I love how she makes me feel. I love our interaction with one another. And she kept saying, it has absolutely nothing to do with gender.
But I ain't thinking about marrying neither one of them.
So, I mean, for her to act like gender don't have nothing to do with it is crazy, because, I mean, I get that you love who you love and all that other kind of stuff. I'm with that. But if you want people to, well, not necessarily accept it, but if you want people to try to wrap their mind around you being with a woman, of course they're going to want to put a title on it. They're going to call you gay, or they're going to call you a lesbian, or they're going to call you homosexual. Well, she kept saying, I don't want a title to be placed on our relationship. But it is kind of is what it is.
Well, like, I mean, you don't want a title to be placed on it, but it is placed on it because you've made that choice. You're married to a woman, so therefore you are in a lesbian relationship.
Didn't her husband go with a man, leave her for a man or something?
Oh, I didn't know that.
No, I didn't hear that.
I think it was something along those lines.
Well, she said she's not with a woman because a man broke her heart or anything. She said, I've been through two bad marriages that didn't work. She said, but I still love the men who I was married to. She said, so I don't know why people are saying that, maybe because I had two bad relationships that now I switched to a woman. She says, no, I just love her. She said, she just happens to come into my life, and, you know, she was a woman, and I just chose to love her. That was her explanation about it. To me, the whole interview was a little strange to me. I read the whole thing. It was like about 4 pages long, and I read it, and I was like, I still don't get it, but...
Oven it, but then call a spade a spade. Call it what it is. You know what I mean? You with a woman. It is what it is. There's no other terminology for it. You're a lesbian. I mean, call a spade a spade.
For some reason, she didn't want to say that, and she says everything, all the comments that she's been getting, I think, are offensive to her. Like, she's like, people are saying that I'm, you know, that I'm gay now. I'm not necessarily gay, but it's kind of like, well, what are you then? You with a woman? Like, I can't call you gay if you with a woman. And that's
you're either gay, lesbian, or bisexual. You're in one of those categories.
Not being a category, but you know, she's on this. I don't want to categorize what our relationship is, and you know, I don't want people to put us in a box, and I don't. But it's like, I mean, you cannot want that, but people won't do it anyway. So
publicity.
Just all of it is. I don't know. But we had this conversation last week. Like I said, I really wish that I knew somebody who was gay or bisexual or lesbian to come on and talk to us, to try to get us to understand how you could be with a man for 35 years and have 17 kids and then decide one day that you're gay. Like, I don't know how that works.
I'm sure they would give it to you straight.
I be trying to understand it, because the funny part, I think I'm a very open-minded person. Like I said, I don't judge people for who they love or who they want to be with or who you want to sleep, because that's your business. But but when you try to understand it, it's very hard for me to understand. Like, I don't get it. Like, I don't understand it at all.
So I don't understand it either, but it's, I mean, choices are choices, and, I mean, everybody is free to choose. But, I mean...
Everybody's free to choose, but the funny part is when you think about it, right now, like if somebody asked you to explain the reason why you're heterosexual, you would be able to explain it, right?
Yeah,
you would
definitely.
Say, well, I'm heterosexual because I'm a woman who enjoys men, I love penis, I love, you know what I'm saying? Like, but when you talk to, like, when I read her interview, I still had more questions in my mind. Like, I still didn't understand it, because to me, she never really said why I'm with a woman now. Like, she never really
said.
But
you know, that makes me think that she's in denial. That is no way that you didn't have some of these feelings prior to even you being married to men. That now you just up and, I don't care what she says, up and marry a woman.
She's like, no, that I just happened to love her. She came into my life at the right time, and I happened to like her, and then we meshed together, and it was all good. She said, I didn't really care about the fact that she was a woman. I just liked her spirit, and I just loved the way she made me feel. And I, like, her interview is, y'all gotta read the interview. I had more, after I read the interview, I had more questions.
I'm a very rational person. I'm a very black and white person. Give me something to read so I can understand it. You understand what I'm saying? But even after I read what she said, I just didn't get it. Like, I didn't get it. She said, no, I didn't pick a woman because men have hurt my feelings, or I didn't pick a woman because I'm a lesbian. I just picked a woman because I loved her. And it's like, okay. Like, I still don't understand it, but okay. All right. I'm
missing.
About me. I don't know. You know, significant age difference between me and him. And it's like, I didn't pick him or, you know, decide that that's who I want to fall in love with or who I want to be with. It just happened. So that's why when I was explaining to people who couldn't accept it originally, I said, it doesn't matter. Like, you love who you love. And it's not like you seek out to say, like she was on a gay website or something like that, you know?
But you know, the difference is, although, like you said, there's a significant age difference, he's still a man. Now, if a woman had pressed up and tried to howl at you, you would have been like, no, you know, thanks for the compliment, but that's not my thing.
I know, I get what you're saying, but I still feel like you have to make a conscious decision when you enter any relationship, whether it be a May-December relationship, whether it be a gay relationship, whether it be a relationship with an older man, whether it be a relationship with a midget. Like, I feel like you decide to make a conscious decision that I'm going to be in this relationship, and you have reasons why you're making this conscious decision. I mean, just saying that you love somebody, I get that. Yeah, you can't choose who you fall in love with, but you do decide whether or not you're going to be with this person, but you decide you're going to be with the person for a certain reason. And after reading her interview, I just didn't get it. Because she kept saying, no, it's not because she's a woman. And no, it's not because I'm gay. And it's no, it's like everything that you think that will be the answer to why she's in a relationship with a woman, she kept saying, no, that ain't it. And it's like, okay, well, what is it? Like, I was still confused.
Did she say she's in that relationship with her because she loved her?
Yeah, she said, I love who I love. She said, I just love who I love, whether they are a man or a woman. So then you go, okay, you're a bisexual. And she goes, well, I'm not in a relationship because I'm bisexual. I'm in this relationship because I love her spirit. And I love, and it's like, okay. Like I said, to the average person,
that would just be her convince herself. That's what I think.
I was just more confused after I read the interview than I was before, because it's like, I just figured when I found out that she was married to a woman, I said, okay, well, she must be gay now. I mean, that's the thing. You be heterosexual for years, and then you turn around and you be gay. Like I said, I don't understand that either, but that's what I pegged it as. Okay, well, she gay now. And she kept saying, well, I'm not in a relationship because I'm gay, and I'm not in a relationship because, you know, this, that, or the other. I'm just in a relationship because I love her. And it's like, I get that, but like, to me, you decide to get into a relationship. You make a conscious decision to say, well, you know, this is the person I love, and I love this person because of this, that, and the third. This is why I'm in this relationship. Like, most people can explain why they are in a relationship. Like, if somebody asks me right now, why are you in a relationship with your husband? I'm in a relationship with my husband because I love him to death. I love the fact that he's family-oriented. I love the fact that, you know, to me, he cares more about me than he cares about himself. Like, I could give you a million and one reasons why I'm in a relationship with my husband. But seemed like everything that was thrown at her during this interview, she kept saying, well, it's not because of that. It's not because of that. It's not because of that. Okay, well, what is it? And her answer was, I married her because I love her. That's just it. It's like, okay. I hear what you're saying, but I still don't understand it. But okay, maybe it ain't for me to understand. I still didn't get it.
I don't think a lot of people understood that response.
I didn't get it. I was, like I said, I was more confused after reading the interview than I was when I even started. And the funny part is, if you're going to be in the same relationship, you have to have some kind of feelings toward the same sex. Like, when you have feelings toward the same sex, don't that make you gay? Or bisexual, at least?
Yeah.
Yeah. She's just trying to dodge it.
You put a title on it.
I think so, too.
You put a title on it.
Yeah.
That's your wife, but okay. But the funny part is, here I go again, though. Did you see this woman that she married? The woman is extra masculine. Like, if you didn't know that she was a woman, you would think she was a man.
Yeah, so she does look like she looks very manly.
Even though you may be gay now, you're still attracted to masculinity because this woman exudes masculinity. She looks like a man. If you didn't know she was a woman, you wouldn't think she was a woman. So, here I go again. if you are a woman and you are attracted to masculine energy, if you get masculine energy from a woman, does that make you gay? I'm confused again. I don't know. Fuck, I don't know how to answer these questions, because even though you're with a woman and she's a woman, but if she looks like a man and she handles herself like a man, that's like being with a man, right? Like, I don't, I'm still confused. I don't know.
I don't even think it's for us to even try and understand. But no, I'm very happy that you are happy, Niecy.
I'm doing my best to try to find somebody who is gay or bisexual to come on the show and talk to us. Because when I tell you, this is one of the very few subjects that I am totally, like, I'm so confused. I'm like, I just don't get it. Like, I don't understand it. And it's not that I'm saying it to be smart. I really don't understand it. I be trying to get it, but I can't. I be going, okay.
Well, let's talk to Vince and get Vince on here one Sunday.
That's a good idea.
You think he would come talk to us? Maybe, because I think he would give us a good perspective. Because it's like, that's my question. It's like, I would love to have a gay man and a gay woman so they can explain
that's it. That's what I was about to say. He would give us a perspective from, you know, the gay male, but he's not a woman. Like, why would you... And what I don't understand is, like, I don't understand that part either, but like I said again, it's not for me to understand. If you're going after a female who is gay but look masculine, why not just have a man if you want that masculine energy?
That's what I'm just saying. Like, if masculine energy is what you're going after, and you get a woman and it looks just like a man, that's kind of like being with a man.
Well, not all of it. You're not getting all the benefits.
But it's like being with a man. Because like I said, if you look at her, the white, I know y'all seen what she looked like. She looked like a dude.
She do, but she missing a major tool.
Yeah, she is missing a major tool. We all know that. But what I'm saying is, she clearly is attracted to the masculine energy that this woman is giving off. And the funny part is, I know all about it. I love masculine energy. I ain't gonna lie. Energy coming from a woman. That's what I'm saying. I can't go that way. And that's just
maybe,
me.
I'm going to play devil's advocate. Maybe she sees it as a double purse. You got the masculine energy, but yet you like their spirit and their soul, and it didn't matter what gender that person was, because she still gets the masculine energy, but she's at a comfort place with that person, regardless if they're male or female. Now, that don't escape the fact that she needs to address this. Not that she has to explain her sexuality to anybody, but that's probably where that came from. Because if it was like, if they both were lipsticks, then it'd be like, wait a minute. But if with him having that masculine energy, but yet still have that spirit and that soul and that comfort that she was seeking, then that's probably what happened.
Well, that part I get. I get the fact that she might be really super comfortable with the female. I get that part. And I even get the whole masculine energy thing. But trying to skip over the fact that this woman doesn't have the tools that a man has, you trying to get everybody to forget about that part. Like, and that's the part. But even like in other kind of relationships, like, you ever see people, I had a girlfriend, I have a black girlfriend who I work with who is married to a white man, okay? And I didn't know people would give her as many problems they give her, because let me tell you, I have been out with her, and I've seen it firsthand. Like, we've been at a club, and when her husband come to pick us up, black men give her a big time problem being married to this white man, only because she's very nice looking, she's very voluptuous, she has a big old booty, big old breath, and when they see her with this skinny white dude, black men seem to become extremely offended. They be like, oh, I know, I was with him one time, and we were leaving a restaurant, and these guys outside was like, I know he can't give it to you the way I was, what you scared of us? Like, they heckled them from the time we walked out of the restaurant door till we got into the car. Now, I've seen that firsthand.
Interracial relationships go through it both ways, because black women will look at,
you're right. They get it from both ends. You're absolutely right. Black women be saying, oh, black too. But I was surprised. I did not know that black people would come at her so hard like that. And she said, oh, that happens all the time. Because I think what it is she's a very, very attractive black woman. And her boyfriend, although he's not ugly, he's kind of like a dork. Like, he's super skinny, he wears glasses, and he's kind of, like, he's kind of dorky, but he's a really nice guy. And I guess the black dude's problem is, like, why is she with this white boy nerd? Like, they can't understand why somebody that looks like her would be with somebody like him. Which is weird because they don't know him, and they don't know his personality and stuff like that. But guess what? I also have a girlfriend who dates, well, she's not married yet. She dates a guy who's a lot younger than her, and people question their relationship a lot as well, too. And the funny part is, only thing about her that I don't understand is she always be ready to fight when somebody say something about her relationship. And I be going, well, I mean, not that anybody should have anything to say because it's technically none of their business.
None of their business.
And that's who you want to be with, and people really shouldn't have to say anything. But my problem with her is that she gets so defensive about it, and it's like, when you got into that kind of relationship, people were going to question it. And now mind you, like I said, it's none of nobody's business at all. It ain't none of nobody's business. You don't have to answer to anybody. But when somebody does question you about it,
he dropped some stuff off at my job one day, and one of the techs that picked the stuff up said, oh, how your son doing? I said, when you see my son? He was like, when he dropped off the food. I said, that's not my son. She was like, oh, okay. And it's like, I don't get defensive. I just tell them, that's not my son.
Exactly.
And then in the market, this one particular cashier would try to be funny every time and would be like, oh, give your mom your ID.
Mm-mm.
I'm like, you know that's not my son. How many times I gotta tell you that's not my son? You know? So, I mean, I don't get defensive. I'll tell you and then be fine. But after that, you know, I shouldn't have to keep telling you.
I agree. That's the right way to handle it. With her, she gets so instantly defensive. She want to fight about it. And it's like, my thing is, you can't be in a relationship that's quote unquote out the norm and think that people, not mind you, not that they should, because they shouldn't. But I would like to think that that's kind of like, you kind of almost expect it. So it's like, okay, I know somebody gonna have something marketing today or whatever. Like, you can't come up with nothing clever to say to people instead of saying, bitch, let's fight. Like, you can't do that all the time. You be fighting the rest of your whole relationship if you wanna fight all the time about it.
Like, my thing is this, I don't think you should let it offend her, because people who make repeated comments, what you don't see is that they are jealous. Because who are they going home to at night? So why would you?
Because people just feel like they always have the right to say something about whatever kind of relationship you're in, and they don't. They don't have the right to say anything.
No.
Necessarily know that
they don't. But if it's repeatedly happening and you've already told them, that's jealousy.
The funny part with her is, I'm seeing you, to me, she's a smart girl. Like, you can't come up with nothing more constructive than let's fight. Like, come on. Like, you can't fight. You'll be fighting your whole life. If you plan on being with this man for the next 20 years, you'll be fighting all the time.
It's not worth it.
Motherfuckers get on my nerves. And I understand. I get it. But people want to say stuff. People want to say smart stuff. They just want to say smart shit all the time. And guess what? You know, they're going to say it behind your neck. Either way, they're going to say it. So, like, figure something out.
And they say, oh, I ain't mad at you. And I just be like, or it's him too. Okay, I ain't mad at you then. You know, when we had to check them in the fresh grocer. Yeah, I said the fresh grocer. You know, but with, like you said, when you get into those type of relationships, you know people gonna hate. But the funny part is, now I'm using your line, if the roles was reversed, and, you know, he was my age and I was his age, nobody gonna say to him, oh, that's your daughter, or get that to your daughter, or something like that. You know what I mean?
I don't think they would say that.
No. Not at all. Because it's different.
It's kind of a double standard, because they expect older men to date younger women. And for some reason, I don't know why they don't expect older students to date younger men. You're right, kind of, in a way. But my thing is this. Like, if you're, whether you be in an interracial relationship, whether it's an age difference, whether it's you dating somebody with a physical inability, you know that somebody along the lines is going to say something. You know what I'm saying? Somebody's going to say something. Like, not that they should, but somebody's going to say something. And I figure, I always tell her all the time, I feel like you need to come up with something better than let's fight. Like, you can't fight everybody. Like, that shit going to get real fast. And I've been on several occasions where she got to fight somebody because somebody done said something about her and this dude. And it's like, come on. Like, you can't want to fight all the time about it. Like, that's crazy.
Not worth it.
But, well, that makes me, that takes me back to Stella, how Stella got a groove back.
Mm-hmm.
When she was there, and the bartender called Winston her son.
She kissed him in the mouth. To me, that's a better retort than wanting to fight somebody. To me, that's a better way to get back. Like, you ain't got to fight. Come up with something, you know, come up with something. And you say, this my son right here. Come here, I'll give him a tongue kiss him down in front of him. Or whatever. But yeah. Like, fighting ain't the way to do it. Fighting ain't the way to do it. Getting mad over it ain't the way to do it. So I was like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. But like I said, back to Miss Nishi Nat. Like I said, however she cares to explain it, but I didn't get it. I'm sorry. I didn't understand it. I just didn't understand her responses to the questions that the interview guy was asking her. Like,
I don't think none of us did, because I don't think she really wanted to answer these questions, because she didn't provide an answer.
She didn't provide an answer. She still left me in the dark. I'm fine, because that's why I was saying, who she married to. She can marry to whoever she wants to be married to. But it's like, why do an interview if you're not going to answer questions?
Exactly.
Do an interview if you don't answer the questions that you're posing. And like I said, that's another thing to me about being a celebrity. When you're a celebrity, you open yourself up to a lot of scrutiny, a lot of unnecessary attention and stuff like that. And if you want to stay in the public eye, sometimes you got to answer questions that you might not be necessarily comfortable with answering. But if that's what you chose in your life, sometimes you got to do it. That's why I would never make a good question. If somebody asked me a question, I'd be just talking, run your business. Like, but I guess when you're a celebrity, you really can't do that to a certain degree. Like, you can try to keep your personal life personal, but eventually somebody going to ask you something. You know what I'm saying? They want to say something or ask you something. I don't know. It's But look, you bring your wife.
Okay.
Enjoy.
But we've actually come to a close on all our issues. We actually were able to discuss everything.
Good. I'm glad. Well, ladies, I hope you'll have a next week. I hope everything goes good on the job. I'll be flying to friend's job in a couple days.
Pray
out the COVID while I'm out there, but I got to run out and do what I got to do and bring my black ass back.
Stay wrapped up on the plan.
All right. I know you got all and everything, so.
What'd you
say? I said, I know you have plenty of masks.
Oh, yeah, I got all kinds of masks. My biggest issue, though, sometimes is people on the plane that don't want to keep their damn masks on the phone. Don't talk to me.
They be trying to take it off.
I even told my boss at one point, I told him I want to go first class. They said, fine, no problem. But guess what? I'm at the point now, y'all might have to buy the seat next to me because I don't want to sit next to nobody. Even though the seats in first class are far apart, you know, they don't have, like, the middle seat. They're kind of spaced apart. But even still, like, I was sitting next to this white dude, and he wanted to take off his mask and ask me, like, 17 questions. Like, I don't want to talk to you. Put your mask back in, bro.
So I thought they were placing, I haven't flew since this whole COVID thing. I thought they had a seat that was supposed to be empty right next to you.
In first class.
Like,
the seats, they don't have a middle seat. They just had two big oversized seats. Now, they do have a kind of like a large space in between the seats.
Yeah, I sat in first class. Don't talk about like in the regular seats.
Plane though, it's like, don't take your mask off, bro. Keep your mask on. He want to talk and ask me all kinds of questions. Don't ask me nothing.
But in the regular seats, in the coach seats, are they spacing them out? Like, do they have an empty seat?
I was on a flight, not the last flight I was on. There were people sitting in the seats, believe it or not.
Unless they're together. If you're together, then you can sit in the middle seat. But if you're not,
so I don't know if they were together or not, but I did see a couple seats where people were sitting, you know, one, two,
She said Key looks like she's having such a good time. She may have to go on down there.
You might have to make a little side appointment. You wouldn't have missed it going down there by yourself.
Nah, I know. I thought you would have done.
All right, gang. Well, y'all have a fabulous this week.
Yeah, y'all have a good next week.